wonderful people. Happy November. I hope it is going well. There have been some issues over here, but I feel like they're more second channel complaints. You know, we try to keep it positive over here. The tech gods have not been so kind. That's why we're saging the crap out of everything over here. But my Wi-Fi has been kind of, screwing me this week. So I'm going to see if we can pre-record it. A quick chapter of The Secret History of the World by Mark Booth. And then I'm going to see if I can get it to upload on a scheduled upload. Also, if it has not gone up yet, Chapter 3 of The Subtle Art of Not Giving Enough by Mark Manson has been filmed and will be up shortly. And I did try to read it nicer this time. Be excited for that. Okay, but this is a very short chapter. I just wanted to get something up here because you guys have been here doing your part, showing up. So thank you for that. If you're not already, please subscribe to Vibe. Smash that thumbs up button because the algorithm will then deem my video worthy to show to some more people. Okay, today we're reading Chapter 8, The Sphinx and the Time Lock. Oh, ring that bell so you always get notified when I upload as well. And comment something nice for the other people in our little community that we're building to read. Because we're almost up to 200 people, and that's so exciting. So I will comment the first nice thing and make a little example for y'all. And then make me proud. The Sphinx and the Time Lock. Orpheus. Daedalus, the first scientist. Daedalus? The first scientist. Solving the riddle of the Sphinx. When Jason set off on the Argos on what proved to be the last hurrah of the demigods and heroes, his boat contained many of the great figures of the age, including Hercules and Theseus. But among these muscle-bound superheroes, there was one with very different powers, a transitional figure who looked forward to life after the demigods and heroes had left, when humans would have to fend for themselves. Orpheus had traveled down from the north, bringing with him the gift of music. His music was so beautiful that it could not only charm humans and animals, it could make trees, even rocks, move. Like frequency movement stuff. If you know what that's called, comment below. So we're starting back at Medea, which is another synchronicity within my semester school in play analysis. On the voyage with Jason, he helped the heroes when brute force could not. Singing and accompanying himself on his lyre, his charm the great clashing rocks that threatened to crush the Argos, and he sent the dragon that guarded the golden fleece to sleep. And dragons! I've been learning about dragons. Did you know dragons are still here? They can use their scales to reflect light off of themselves so that they cannot be seen. And they do just that. Very cool. On his return, he fell in love with Eurydice. But on the day of their wedding, she was bitten on the ankle by a snake and died. Half blinding by grief, Orpheus descended into the underworld. He was determined not to accept the new order of life and death, determined to win her back. Death was now a terrible thing, no longer a welcome rest when the spirit recuperated and refreshed itself in preparation for its next incarnation. It was a painful separation from those you love. Descending deeper and deeper, Orpheus encountered the grim old ferryman Charon, who at first refused to row him across the river Styx to the land of the dead. But Charon was charmed by the lyre, as was Cerberus, the three-headed dog whose job was to guard the entrance to the underworld. Orpheus charmed too. Terrible demons, whose task was to tear from the spirits of the dead the unregenerated animal lusts and savage desires that still clung to them. Finally, he reached the place where the king of the underworld held his love captive. The king was not unequivocally charmed by Orpheus, because the release he granted was not unconditional. There was just one small condition. Eurydice could return to the world of the living if Orpheus could lead her up there without ever once turning round to make sure she was following. But of course Orpheus, at the last moment, as the sunlight hit his face, perhaps worried he was being tricked by the king, did turn round. He saw the love of his life suddenly pulled back down away from him, down the stone passageways, out of sight, fading into the underworld like a wisp of smoke. The other more muscle-bound heroes had succeeded in their quest by fighting the good fight to the limits of their strength and endurance, by being brave and never giving up. But times were changing. The great initiates who preserved this story for us wanted us to understand that Orpheus failed because he tried to do what every good hero had done. He tried to make sure. It may also be that his music loss had some of its charm, because it did not stop a band of Maenads, the female followers of Dionysus, throwing themselves upon him and tearing him limb from bloody limb. They threw his head into the river, where it floated downstream, still singing. As it floated by, the weeping willows crowded the banks. Finally, the head of Orpheus was rescued and set on an altar in a cave, where crowds came to consult it as an oracle. If Cadmus Enoch named this planets and the stars, it was Orpheus who measured them, and by measuring them, invented numbers. There are 8 notes in an octave, but in a sense really only 7, as the 8th always represents elevation to the next octave. The octaves then refer to ascent through the 7 spheres of the solar system, spheres which, in antiquity, were central to all thought and experience. By giving a system of notation, Orpheus was originating mathematics. Concepts could be manipulated, paving the way for the scientific understanding of the physical universe. Orpheus is a transitional figure because on the one hand, he is a magician with the power to move stones with music. But on the other, he is a forerunner of science. Later, we will see a similar ambiguity in many great scientists, even in modern times. But the other representative of the transition taking place at the time of Orpheus was Daedalus. We know he was a contemporary because he was the keeper of the Minotaur, killed by Theseus, who joined in the quest for the Golden Fleece. Daedalus is famous for making wings out of wax and feathers to help him and his son Icarus to escape from Crete. He also designed the labyrinth and is credited with inventing the saw and the snail. So he was an inventor, an engineer, an architect in ways we would recognize today. He did not use magic. If science was an innovative of the age, so too was magic. Magic was the application of a scientific way of thinking to the supernatural. In this age, we no longer see the seemingly effortless shape-shiftings of earlier ages, or the turning of those who have offered into spiders, stags, or plants. Instead, we see Jason's wife, Medea, and Circe, to whom Medea went for help, advice, and magical protection. Circe and Medea had to work in order to achieve their supernatural effects, using potions, spells, incantations, If the invention of words and numbers enabled humans to begin to manipulate the natural world, it also gave them the idea of being able to manipulate the spirit worlds. Medea offered Jason a blood-red potion made from the juice of the crocus to soothe the dragon that guarded the fleece. She used chants and spirits of juniper to spray the dragon's eyelids. She dealt in magic elixirs and knew the secrets of the snake charmer. As the material world continued to become denser, and as the beings of the spirit worlds were increasingly squeezed out, even the lowest level of spirits, the nature spirits, the sylphs, dirids, naiads, and gnomes became elusive. They seemed to disappear into the streams, trees, and rocks, fleeing the first light of dawn. But they still seemed tantalizingly close, and it was these nature spirits, then as now, that magicians found easier to manipulate. Some magicians tried to bend the great gods to their will, too, to draw them down from the moon. The myths of the original werewolf, Lycan, who promoted the flood of Declan, of Poseidon's flooding of the Thracian plain, causing Athena to move her city to the present site of Athens, and of the terrible storms that persuaded Medea wherever she went, are depictions of the environmental catastrophes resulting from the practice of blood magic. At the end of this period, humanity is sick, and so too is nature. Orpheus might have failed by the standards of the conventional hero, but his influence on history was greater and more long-lasting than that of Hercules, Theseus, and Jason. The music Orpheus originated would be a balm for healing the sick and troubled spirit of humanity down the millennia. If people were becoming isolated, not only from the gods, but from one another, if they were worn down by an always harsh and sometimes hostile environment, and if their imaginations were infected by the perverse and bestial impulses of magic, all of this could now be countered by the aesthetic influence on the imagination, not only through music, but also literature, painting, and sculpture. Inspiring images of beauty, truth, and love would work on humanity at a level below that of the conscious mind. They would be more powerful than any explicit abstract moral teaching. Orpheus was the mythical founder of the Greek mysteries that would lighten up and inspire ancient Greece. Perhaps the most powerful artistic expression of the spiritual crisis at the end of the age of the heroes appears in the Bible. In the written form it has come down to us, the story of Job is one of the later texts of the Old Testament. But in its origins, it is one of the older parts. Job was a good man, yet he lost all his money. His sons and daughters died. Left all alone, he was covered with a plague of boils. Meanwhile, the wicked prospered. The story of Job is remembered today, not because he was a great leader or doer of great deeds, but because he was the first human being ever to think a very important and deeply true thought. Life is unfair. Hercules had been the sport of the gods, but it was Job who cried out to the heavens in defiance. Unlike Hercules, Job had the language to do this. Today we take it for granted that we have enough mental maneuverability to choose what to think about. However, before the invention of language, which was the great achievement of this age, such maneuverability would not have been possible. Language enables us to distance ourselves from the world. It helps us to withdraw from what is physically present and can enable us to break down experience, whether present or not, into bits we can manipulate. To some degree, we can put experience into order as we wish. There is an alienating element to this process, as well as the advantages it brought. Language made the world a colder, darker, and trickier place. We saw earlier how thinking is itself a deadening process. Language, too, makes us unhealthy, less vividly alive, and less sure-footed in our wanderings in the world. So language brought with it a new form of consciousness. Before Job, people felt that everything that happened to them was meant to happen to them, that there was a divine purpose behind everything. They could not question this. Now language enabled Job to step back. He began to notice inconsistencies. Life is unfair. But God revoked Job for understanding so little. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth, when morning stars sang together, and all the angels shouted for joy? Have you entered the springs of the sea, or walked the depths of the deep? Have the gates of death been opened to you? Do you know where the sun lives and where the darkness comes from? Can you bind the chains of the Pleiades or loose the belt of Orion? What saved Job was that he had the sense we all have when we awake from a wonderful dream, when we try to bring it back but cannot. He was aware that the range of human experience was in some way diminishing. Oh, that I was as in the times of old, when God watched over me, when his lamp shone on my head. Job 29:2-4. Job refers, of course, to the lantern of Osiris. Today the word apocryphal carries pejorative associations, but really it means hidden or esoteric. In the apocryphal testament of Job, he was rewarded for being conscious of what he did not know, conscious of what he lost. Job's sons and daughters were returned to him, his daughters bearing golden girdles. One belt gave Job the ability to understand the language of the angels, the second, the secrets of creation, and the third, the language of the cherubim. Music, mathematics, and language were invented in the age of the heroes, and so too was astronomy, another achievement attributed to Enoch. The first stone circles not only marked out the dispositions of the hierarchies of the gods and angels, they marked out the positions of the stars and planets. In the secret history, therefore, it now becomes possible for the first time to begin to fix the dates of great events. Between the lion paws of the Sphinx at Giza, gazing eastwards, is a large stone that carries the inscription, "This is the splendid place of the first time." The first time, or Zeptepi, was a mysterious phrase the Egyptians used to allude to the beginning of time. In their mythology, Zeptepi was marked by the rising of the pre-immortal mound out of the waters and the aligning on it of the phoenix. A remarkable feat of reconstruction, which he began while standing between the paws of the Sphinx, Robert Bovell has managed to determine the date of Zeptepi. In Egyptian lore, the phoenix always arrived to mark the beginning of a new age. In Egyptian mythology, the phoenix, or Bennu bird, is the symbol of the Sothic cycle of 1460 years, which is the time it took the Egyptians, 365-day calendar, to resynchronize with the beginning of the yearly cycle, marked by the heliacal rising of Cyrus. The synchronization of these two cycles, the yearly and Sothic, took place in 11,451, 10,081, 7,160, 4,241, and 2,781 BC. Bovell noticed immediately that these dates coincided with the commencement of some of the great building projects up and down the Nile. Clearly, the starting of the sequence of cycles was very important to the ancient Egyptians. Trying to figure out which of these cycles might have been the first one, he was initially attracted by the idea that it might be 10,081 BC because of an esoteric tradition that the Sphinx had been built at this time or even earlier. Then Bovell worked out that on the earlier date of 11,451 BC, the Milky Way, which had immense significance in ancient cultures around the world as the River of Souls, was lying directly over the course of the Nile, so that they mirrored each other. Moreover, it struck him that on this very early date of 11,451, the Sothic and yearly cycles coincided with a third cycle, the Great Year, the 25,920-year-long complete cycle of the zodiac. In a most meaningful way, because on that date, the lion-bodied Sphinx's eastwards gaze would have taken in the dawning of the age of Leo. The Sphinx embodies the four cardinal constellations of the zodiac, the four corners of the cosmos, Leo, Taurus, Scorpio, and Aquarius. The four elements that work together to make the material world. The Sphinx, according to the secret history, in a monument to the first time, the four elements locked into place, with the result that matter finally became solid. When in the Timaeus, Plato famously wrote of the word soul being crucified on the word body, he was not forcifying the crucifixion of Christ, as some Christian apologists have supposed. He was recalling this crucial moment in world history as idealism conceives it, when consciousness was fixed in solid matter. The Sphinx, therefore, had a very special place in history as idealism tells it. It marks the point when, after wave upon wave of emanations from the cosmic mind, solid matter as we know it today was finally formed. That is why it is perhaps the greatest icon of the ancient world. The laws of physics, as we know them today, were only then set in motion. And from that point on, the dates can be firmly fixed, because the great clock of the cosmos was finally set in its complex pattern of orbits. In this late solidification of matter, where what actually happened, it would, of course, invalidate dating methods such as carbon-14 conventionally used to try to establish early chron. Modern science makes an assumption in its calculations that the ancients did not, namely that the natural laws have held true in all places and at all times. The Sphinx asks Oedipus a riddle. Now we're at Oedipus. What walks on four legs, then two legs, then three legs? If he cannot answer it, the Sphinx will kill him. But he correctly interprets it as a riddle concerning the age. Comment the answer now if you know it. Spoilers coming. The ages of man. A baby walks on four legs, grows up to walk on two legs, until so old that a third leg or walking stick is needed. But ages, here is also another way of alluding to the evolution of humanity. The form of the Sphinx is a monument to this evolution. The Sphinx is defeated by the acumen of Oedipus and casts itself into the precipice or abyss. The Sphinx's dying is a way of showing that the gods of the elements, the organizing principles of the universe, became successfully absorbed inside the human body at this time. Central to the Oedipal legend is the terrible fate he hoped, but failed to avoid. He dully killed his father and became his mother's lover. As the laws of nature became fixed and mechanical, humans were trapped in them. So the Sphinx marks the end of the age of metamorphosis, the fixing of the biological forms we know today, as well as the fixing of the laws of nature. It also bars the way back. In Genesis, it is one of the cherubim who bars the way back into Eden. Similarly, the Egyptians called the Sphinx Hu, meaning protector. By this, they meant that he guarded against any slide back into the old ways of procreation. It's a common misconception that in 1650, when Bishop Usher famously calculated the date of creation as 4004 BC, this was some last vestige of ancient superstition. In fact, Usher's calculation was the product of a time when materialism was gaining ground, and his was a narrow literal interpretation of the Bible that would have seemed absurd to the ancients. They believed that human souls had existed for vast, immeasurable eras before 11,451 BC, and that only then did the human body as we know it today fully materialize around the human spirit. It is interesting to note that according to the calculations of Manetho in the 3rd century BC, this is almost exactly the time when the reign of the demigods came to an end. We will see later that, according to esoteric doctrine, Not only was matter precipitated out of mind a short while ago, but that it exists only for a brief interval. It will dissolve again in just over 9,000 years when the sun rises again to meet the gaze of the Sphinx in the constellation of Leo. In the teachings of the secret societies, we live on a small island of matter in a vast ocean of ideas and imagination. Next time we read The Secret History of the World by Mark Booth, we will be reading Chapter 9, The Neolithic Alexander the Great. Thank you so much, my loves, for doing your part and showing up. If you've not already, please subscribe to Vibe, smash that thumbs up button, the algorithm loves it, and will then deem my video worthy to show some more people. Ring that notification bell if you have not already. Yes, that was my interpretation of ringing a bell. Upside down, I suppose. Ring. And, comment something nice for the next person to read. We need it. Thank you so much, my loves. Be sure to come back next time. Bye.